There's a path along life's highway, so common and well trod. By the shoes of burden of Christians who won't put their trust in God.
Welcome to The Liberating Secret with your host, author, and teacher, Sylvia Pierce. The Liberating Secret is dedicated to revealing the mystery of the gospel, which is Christ in you, the only hope of glory. Let's join Sylvia Pierce for today's lesson.
He died and rose again, set me free.
Welcome to The Liberating Secret. My name is Sylvia Pierce. So glad to be with you today. I hope you tuned in yesterday for the program. I was talking about intercession. You see, in Timothy, Paul was writing to Timothy, and I noticed the other day in chapter 2, verse 1, it says, I exhort you, therefore, that first of all, supplications and prayers and intercessions and giving thanks be made for all men. Okay, so he's exhorting us that prayer and intercession. So he divides the difference between prayer and intercession. And that's what we've been talking about. There is a difference between prayer and intercession. And I just read a chapter, or part of the chapter, last time from Reese House Intercessor, which is a fabulous book. It's probably the best book out there for Christians to read if you really want to understand what intercession is. And what Reese House says, intercession, prayer is intense prayer, is intense. It can be intense. However, intercession is different because intercession is actual calling, and there's three, it really talks about the principles of intercession, and there's three of them, or three laws of intercession, which is not law like legalism, but law like principle, three principles of intercession. One is a call, the second is the agony, third is the authority. So you see, once God has chosen a vessel like he did Paul, and if we read in Acts, and I want to read to you again in Acts chapter 9, his calling, which was given to Ananias, and I think it's very important to see, it says, this is what God said to Ananias when Ananias didn't want to go lay hands on Paul. Because he heard that he was persecuting the church as Saul. So this is what the Lord says in verse 15 of chapter 9 of Acts. But the Lord said to him, go thy way, for he, Paul, or Saul, is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. Wow. For my name's sake. To bring about what the Holy Spirit intends to bring about on earth. So now we also realize that Isaiah and Ezekiel both say that God is looking for a man to stand in the gap, to be an intercessor, to stand between the person that is blind, that is a sinner, and God. You see? Now, that has to be a chosen vessel. That has to be a cleansed vessel. That has to be a vessel that has no self-interest of his own, not for ambition or family interest or any of those things. So it's a very severe calling that God calls us to. And actually, the book of Acts says that. It says that if you want to be my disciple, Jesus said it, then you have to hate father, mother, daughter, family member, and yea, even your own self. Wow. Now that's pretty severe. Now why would God say it, or why would Jesus say it that way? Well, the severity of it is not that you actually hate these people. That's not love. That's not what he means. But you hate a self that has to have those people for yourself, or for your own interest of yourself, you see. So there's a real stripping away of any self-interest and self-advancements for self, you see. That God, only the Holy Spirit takes you through. Now, there's so many people that have thought, well, we have got to now crucify ourselves. No, the Holy Spirit takes you through these places, these cross places, these places of the cross. And how in the world can a person really hate themselves? Well, it's not that you hate yourself, you hate your self-life. You hate a life of your own. And you see, you're forever called to the life of Christ within you. The Holy Spirit using your vessel, your vesselhood, or your personhood to express His life through. And it's a sacrificial life. It's a laid down life. It's not a life, you know, me for me for me. It's not about me. It's not about my advancements or my prosperity or my, gaining for me. It's not about me. It's about what God wants to accomplish through me for other people. And that's really what an intercessor is. And you're called to it. And like Jonah, tried to run away from his calling. But God made sure he was spilled out by the whale, or the big fish, the great fish that spit him out right at Nineveh. He never did really appreciate his calling. It doesn't matter. God can put you in a place and He'll hold you there. And it's the Holy Spirit holding you there because He's accomplishing a gained position so that you will have the authority for evangelism, to bring people to Christ or form Christ in people. And that's been the intercession that God has given me, is that Christ will be formed in the body of Christ, and so that we will consider everything done for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ, and not knowing that we don't have our own righteousness, but we live by the life and the righteousness of Christ. Now, that's what God has given me to give to the body of Christ, and I do it however the door is open, and I'm expecting new doors to open. I'm expecting that this year. This is 2013. I'm expecting new doors. If they don't open for me in person, they will open for the people that will further this ministry to bring Christ, our life, to the Christian world and the liberating secret to the Christian world. I've been reading in chapter 4 of 2 Corinthians, which is the perfect chapter on how death works in us, but life works in other people, in the intercessor. So death situations will happen to you. So many people say, why does this happen to me? I don't understand. I've been a good person. I've done good things. It's not that God is against goodness. He's against our own goodness, that's for sure, because we don't have any our own goodness. Our only righteousness that we have is the righteousness of Christ. There is no such thing as human righteousness apart from the righteousness of Christ within us. So it's not about what I've done or what I haven't done. It's what God has called us to. And God will call you to a place, and there will be a cross in it. It will cost you. It will cost your reputation. It may cost what not only your family thinks about you, but maybe your fellowship thinks about you, or your neighborhood, or your city, or what even you might even think about yourself. You wonder about yourself, you see. It could cost you that. It could cost you more than that. Some people have lost their marriages. Some people have gone through because they stood for Christ, you see. Some people have lost their ministries because they stood for Christ. I mean, outer ministry. You can't lose the ministry that God gives you in spirit, but maybe the outer form of that ministry has been lost for the excellency of Christ. And there will be a cost, but in that cost there will be fruit, because Jesus said it, the law of the harvest is this: if a grain of wheat or a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, and if it die, if you pay a price, you see, you will bear fruit. So you can know that God is giving you the authority to stand fast in the places of what you want and what you desire in spirit for people. You will get it. And I had my old missionary friend Norman Grubb said that you might die not seeing it, not seeing the fullness of it, but you'll certainly get a piece of the pie. So you'll see the beginning of what God is going to bring on the earth before you even pass on from this side. My mother paid the price of an intercessor and laid her life down when she had the authority really to be healed from her cancer. That's a part of the atonement. Christ gave us that by his stripes we are healed. And she chose rather to not take that privilege and give new life to us as an intercessor. And she did that. And before she died, she on her hand, she named 10 things that she was asking and demanding from God. And because of it, the fruit of the ministry that I have today comes from the fact that my mother laid her life down early. She could have been healed. She could have been, and she passed that up. You know, there's a verse in the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, that says they refused deliverance that they might get a greater resurrection. And the greater resurrection is certainly that the people that she was believing for would bring life inside of them. And she has certainly gained that for all of us, and we are so thankful to her. And she is thankful. She would have done it a million times. And from the other side, she sees exactly what God is bringing forth and all the people that she believed for. And she's in joy in heaven, I can tell you that. But let me read you something from Philippians that Paul says about his gained intercession. It says, it's in Philippians chapter 1, verse 12. And this is a prison letter. He was in prison when he wrote this. And by the way, this is the same letter that he says. He says, I've learned to be content in whatever state I'm in. Whether I'm abound, I'm content. Whether I'm abased, I'm content. Because he's living the abundant life of Christ within. And then he says, and I know that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. In other words, I can suffer the greatest sacrifice. Or I can have the greatest riches. It doesn't matter, because equally, you know, I love it that they're kind of both imposters. The point is, the outer thing are imposters, really. The real inner thing is that he could be content. And from this contentment, he knows he can do all things through Christ who strengthens him. It's through Christ who strengthens him. And he can't do it through himself, but he can certainly do it through Christ. Verse 12 in Philippians chapter 1 says this, but I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that the things which happened unto me have fallen out rather for the furtherance of the gospel. So there's nothing that happened to him that wasn't for the furtherance of the gospel. And I will say that even till the day I die, whatever happens to me and befalls me is really for the furtherance of the fullness of the gospel, that the body of Christ might have the fullness of the gospel. So that my bonds and my imprisonments in Christ are manifest in all places and in all other places. My bonds in Christ. He's not saying my bonds because Nero, the Pharaoh, has put me into prison. No, he's not saying that. He's saying my bonds are in Christ. I'm bound to Christ and his suffering and his life and his afflictions, the Bible even says, that Christ might be manifest in every place I'm in. You know, a lot of people say when I get old, I never want to go to the nursing home. And I always say, you mean Jesus doesn't want to go to the nursing home? Maybe Jesus might need to go to the nursing home. I mean, how can you say I can never do this or I can never do that? How do you know? I mean, Jesus might need to go to the nursing home. I'm not going to say that to my children. I might need to. You know, I don't know where Jesus needs to go in me. And many of the brethren in the Lord wax confident by my bonds. In other words, the more he's persecuted, the more fervor that everybody else, and the more confidence all the other apostles and the other disciples have because of his bonds, are made more bold to speak the word without fear. You see, that happens. When the devil persecutes one person, it makes everybody else have more confidence and are bolder giving the gospel. Some indeed preach Christ, even of envy and strife, and some also of goodwill. The one preached Christ of contention, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my bond. So some people preach Christ and it's a mockery. That's what they're trying to do. But the other of love, knowing that I am set for the defense of the gospel, that's his whole life, was for the defense of the gospel. He was holding forth, standing in the gap for the defense of the gospel. What then? Notwithstanding every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached, and I therein do rejoice, yea, and will rejoice. For I know that this should turn to my salvation through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, according to my earnest expectation and my hope. That's really what hope is earnest expectation, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness as always, so now always Christ shall be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or by death. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. So whether I live, it's Christ. Whether I die, it's Christ. I'm telling you, that's my calling too. Whether I live, it's Christ. Just recently, the doctors told me I had breast cancer. Okay, if I live, it's Christ. If I die, it's Christ. It's Christ crucified. And Christ, the gospel must go on to the Christian world. And I'm telling you, the gospel is not being preached in the Christian world like it should be. People are not truly being born again because of the gospel, the great gospel of Christ. And I'm standing in that gap, that the gospel of Christ be preached to the lost world, and also to the Christians, that they might know the fullness of the gospel, that Christ lives in them and he is their very life. But if I live in the flesh, this is the fruit of my labor. Yet what I should choose, I want not. For I am in a strait between two, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to abide in the flesh is more needful for you. You see, when the doctors told me that I had breast cancer, I said, well, Lord, okay, is it my time? And I thought, no, I haven't finished my course. I haven't finished my course. And I said, like Hezekiah, I said, Lord, I want 15 more years. Now I'm 71 years old. I want 15 more years added to my life, at least. If the world lasts that long, and that's always a condition. And why? It's not for me. I mean, I've got a wonderful family. I've got a great husband. My family's won to the Lord. My grandchildren are being won to the Lord by their parents. And I have a ministry, and I've been giving out the liberation to the body of Christ. I've been giving that out, but my course is not finished. And if I live, it's not unto me. It's so that I might be able to finish the course that God has given me, in order that you might know the fullness of Christ living in you. That's why I live. So whether I die or whether I live, it's for one purpose. And having this confidence, I know that I shall abide and continue with you all for your furtherance. And I'm saying that for myself too. And the joy of faith, that your rejoicing may be more abundant in Jesus Christ for me by my coming to you again. And of course, that's what Paul is saying to the Philippians. Oh my gosh, what a great man of God. What a great intercessor. Now, the whole problem in Corinthians really begins in 1 Corinthians, when he was considered not to be a true apostle. And there were false apostles coming among them, smearing his reputation, trying to destroy the work of the Spirit that the Spirit began through him. So in 1 and 2 Corinthians, he gives very, very deep things. And in 2 Corinthians especially, is a very deep letter that he is writing to these Corinthians, who he says is yet carnal, still fleshly, but he's writing these deep things. So therefore, I know that you, the body of Christ, are able to take these deep things that God wants to give you. Because this life, you know, so much is taught about outer prosperity. I think we have missed the point of why Jesus has come. Has Jesus come to give us outer riches? Or has Jesus come to lay his life down so that we might be made rich by his poverty? Is that riches, outer riches? Well, you know, it's wonderful. I mean, I have a nice home. I mean, actually, our house was actually given to us. We actually paid $1 for it. If you want to come to my house, it's 120 feet long. I live in a nice neighborhood. I have a nice house. We have nice cars. I have nice furniture. I mean, I'm not bashing that at all. But rather, is that really the point? Is that the point, that God would give me a comfortable world to live in and not, you know, and depend on outer riches instead on him who is able to really make me rich on the inside? What is better, to have inner riches and be poor on the outside, or to have outer riches and be poor on the inside? I would much rather have an indwelling riches within, because I know I have Christ within, you see. So I think our Christian world has been inundated enough with the sense of God wants to make you prosperous. I'm sorry to be the one that delivers this message, but it's true. It is true. God is calling forth intercessors. He's calling forth people that will stand in the gap, that will take suffering, the sufferings of Christ, upon themselves. And you see, it won't be us that will get ourselves through. There's many times that I've thought to myself, I can't get through. I'm so depressed. I cannot get through. But yet, I turn to my Lord, and he pulls me through. And I know the victory comes in me. And when the victory comes in me, I know it comes in other people as well. And I know that I have the authority to stand in faith for other people. And I do. I pray and I stand in faith for many people. I know this one woman that has been on my breastplate, and I believe that we're like Aaron. We have an invisible breastplate because we're called kings and priests. And as a priest, we're like Aaron. We have 12 stones on our breastplate. And yes, we will go through very hard times. The things that we think we like and we want, we may not be able to have. And maybe there will come a time of suffering that's coming in our life. Well, we will know that we're not going to be able to have the things that we're used to. And we're not going to be whining little babies like the children of Israel sitting in their tents whining over the lox and the garlics that they had in Egypt, instead of wanting the fullness of what Moses had, which was the Shekinah glory shining out through his face. Now, we are Christians. Now, we have the glorious Christ living within us. And regardless of what we have to walk through, what we have to go through, we can have confidence that he is able inside of us to deliver us from every outer trial and tribulation and make us stand victorious in the midst of it and show forth his faith and his love because of it. Now, let me tell you a story. I have friends that live in West Pittston, Pennsylvania. They have a great Victorian house. It went back like three generations. I think her grandmother, her great-grandparents lived in that house. Beautiful, beautiful house in West Pittston, Pennsylvania. And one day, it was Christmas time, they left their house. Unbeknownst to them, they had a lit candle. They did not realize that it was still lit at Christmas time. You light candles. They went to a movie. When they came home, their house had burned down. Now, my friend has a great singing voice, and she started singing the song, which I wish I could sing to you, Beauty for Ashes. She started singing that song when she saw her house in ashes, and she started praising the Lord. Now, you can't do that unless you've got the victorious one living inside of you. And she does. And she and her husband both went through. It was hard for them. Now, they've rebuilt their house, and the insurance paid for it, and it ended up being wonderful. But it's a house of prayer for that area. They have gained an intercession, a place in that area where people come to learn the liberating truth. And she says she's a part of our church, and of course we always say we don't really have membership in our church unless you're a member of the body of Christ, whoever you are, and where it's a universal membership in the body of Christ. That's the only membership we have in our church. But I laugh sometimes and say I have an underground mega church, because we get to broadcast through the internet to the world, the worldwide broadcasting network that we have, and we call it Spirit Broadcasting Network. We get to transmit to the whole world and give the liberating truth to the world. So we're so thankful for that, and we're thankful for the people that, you know, we forget the what we have today. People have laid their lives down for, even the outer freedoms that we have, people have laid their lives down. And we're walking on dead men's bones, and without appreciation, if we don't fully appreciate the people that have come before us. Just think of the Apostle Paul and what he suffered in his lifetime. Now, we're going to go through that when we get to chapter 11. And let me just read a few things in chapter 11 that will just absolutely stun us. He says this. He says, 3 times I was beaten with a rod. Once I was stoned. 2x I suffered shipwreck, a night and a day in the deep. In journeys often. In other words, he walked from place to place. It says, I suffered in perils in waters. What does that mean? Maybe in shipwrecks. And he was in the water at one point. In perils and robbery. In perils by many, by my own countrymen, in other words, his own Jewish brothers persecuted him. By perils of the heathen, perils of cities, perils in the wilderness, perils in the sea, perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. Besides these things, without that which cometh upon me daily, the care for all the churches.
You have been listening to The Liberating Secret with Sylvia Pierce. We want to send a special thank you to all our supporters who make this program possible. If you have been blessed by this program and would like to contact Sylvia, you can write her at P.O. Box 43268, Louisville, Kentucky 40253. That's Post Office Box 43268, Louisville, Kentucky 40253. You can also find more of Sylvia's teachings on her website. The web address is www.theliberatingsecret.com. That's www.theliberatingsecret.com. And be sure to listen again right here Monday through Friday at the same time for The Liberating Secret with author and teacher Sylvia Pierce. So until next time, may God richly bless you.